So our topic today is acceptance. So are you ready to accept what I'm going to say? Yes? But you need not accept what I'm going to say. I have accepted that you may accept, you may not accept. You may accept partially or and not accept partially. Anything. So, what is acceptance? That whatever happens in my life, I should just accept it. Is it some type of complacency? Or is it just resignation to whatever happens to my life? If you have to think about acceptance and explain what is acceptance, what would you say? Does acknowledgement and acceptance mean the same? That if something happens, I acknowledge it and I say this is what it is, and I say that I approve. Approval and acceptance is the same.
Recognition of what is.
Perfect. Recognition of what is called acceptance. But only recognition. It is not any other response or any other emotion associated with that. So acceptance is like an acknowledgement of the fact as it is. Summer has started. Acknowledge it. Accept. It is very hot. Accept. India did not win the semi-final match. Accept. New Zealand did not win the finals. Accept. Same way, positive also. Positive aspect also. That I got success, I accept. Somebody whom I love dearly is, now has come back to me or is a part of my life. Accept. Both positive and negative. Acknowledgement of a situation or a person or a thing as it is called as acceptance. Now, just because I accept it does not mean I approve that this is right or this is good or this is how it should be. Because many of us confuse acceptance with approval. I say, no, I can't accept this person. But the person is what he is. Or the situation is what it is. Whether my accepting or not, that is not going to change that. Accepting will only make me more open to it. Then I can see what to do with that. Suppose I say that I know that the tiger is harmful, dangerous animal. Now I accept it. No? Then I know, okay, when tiger comes, then I need to run. I say, no, I don't accept this tiger is like that. I am going to tame the tiger then. So acceptance does not mean approval. Acceptance is only acknowledging. This is what it is. And why that is very important? Because only when I accept something as it is, will my response to it will be appropriate. Otherwise it will be a response that is conditioned by my mind. I may not like it. I may dislike it. I may not Like Arjun did not accept the situation as it is. So he wanted to run away. Fact is, he has to kill his own grandfather and his own teacher. He has to accept the fact. Non-acceptance of the fact can completely change my decision, can completely change the outcome of whatever I do in my life. And acceptance will bring me back to the realities as they are. Hence, to do anything in life, whether I want success in relationship, I want success at my work, whether I want spiritual growth, whatever I want to achieve in my life, acceptance is the first step. So it is not a passive resignation, but an active recognition that things are the way they are. Whether I like it or not, it doesn't depend on my like and dislike. It is. This is the way it is. Whether I like it or not, whatever is happening in the country is happening. If I don't accept it, I may keep resisting, keep fighting. What will that do? I will accept it and then I can also resist it. There is no problem in that. The whole approach will be very different after that. So acceptance is not a passive resignation to whatever is. Okay, chalo, now I accept, now what else to do? It is an active recognition that things are the way they are and acknowledge them. And so it is not again complacency. It is not against any improvement or change. Many people think like that, that if I accept, then I have approved it, then I can't change that. But it is not like that. There was one person who had brought up puppy, and for the good of that puppy, he wanted to feed cod liver oil to that puppy. So what he used to do, this was very young, just small, so he used to catch that puppy, bring his face between his knees, hold it very tightly, and then feed that cod liver oil. Now this person kept doing that. Now he has grown into a full, proper dog now. Still he does that. Holds it very tightly and then feeds the cod liver oil. One day this dog resisted and broke free. So the cod liver oil bottle which was there in the hand, it fell, it broke. And the dog ran and drank that cod liver oil. It was then that this person realized that it is not that the dog doesn't want to drink that cod liver oil. It is a method that he was administering which was not appropriate. Now the moment that was understood that the dog is not resisting that, that understanding of that situation changed his whole approach. That he started accepting the dog as it is. It is his conditioning in the mind from the beginning that the dog will not like cod liver oil. So I have to hold the dog like this only and I have to feed the dog forcibly. Now non-acceptance of a situation will create so many imaginations in the mind that one goes away from the reality. So many times it is not that people don't want to do certain things, but the way in which we do, because we already assume that this person will resist, this person will do like this person will do like that. But if we accept that person, that why that person is doing like that, we will be able to understand the situation properly. Then whatever we need to do, we can always do. So it is not a passive resignation or it is not some complacency that if I accept then, you know, I can't change. It is something which can be done actively. Once I accept, so many things are easier. So we always say that to face, to achieve anything in life, we need these two aspects. I need to face life, then I can make life. Acceptance helps me to face my life as it is and not escape from it. Then only I can make my life. The faster I come in contact with the situation as it is and learn to accept it, I can make what I want. And even in those situations where it appears I cannot do anything, again acceptance is required or not. That I have done everything at this moment, now I cannot do anything. Krishna Bhagavan himself tried to convince the Kauravas that why are you doing this? Why should a war happen? But it didn't work. So he had to accept the fact that this is like this now. And then the war had to happen. So the faster one comes to recognize that this is what it is, the easier it is to face life. And the decisions we make will be according to that. So we always say that acceptance is the key to happiness, because life will go through ups and downs. There is no, it will never be flat. Acceptance will help me to accept both peak and the valley. In our situation, what happens? We would like to accept the peak and resist the valley. How that will work? So they go together. And hence it is said that acceptance is choiceless. There is actually no choice but to accept the thing as it is. But the moment I accept something as it is, it will open up all choices. Wherever I have a choice, it will open up all those choices. And where I don't have a choice also, it will open up the peace and happiness, because then I can say that bus, I cannot do anything more. What doesn't allow me to accept is my insistence and my ego. That's all. And is it not true that eventually I will come around and accept only? After all the fretting and fuming, what I can do? I will have to accept that this is what it is. Then why unnecessarily do so much? There was one person, one couple, they had a child after long time. Many things they tried, and then prayers and all that, and they had a child. And this child was growing up very well, just 2 years old. Father goes for work. Mother is taking care of the house and the family. So the child, one day the mother is cooking something in the kitchen, and this child happens to open some bottle of medicine and just swallow something. And that child in a few hours time passes away. So when the husband comes home, he's very shocked. Now, what do you think that the husband's reaction will be? Blame the wife. Naturally. Anything else? The husband comes home. He, of course, is feeling sad. But he goes to the wife, just gives her a hug and says that I love you and I'm with you. Doesn't do anything. Why? Because what has happened by her, by his blaming, shouting, firing, what is going to happen? It's only going to create more agitation in the relationship. It is not that she wanted this to happen. Inadvertently something happened. Very difficult to accept at that point in time, but that person showed that maturity, accepted. So if he had not accepted, what would have happened? So many times it happens to us also. We get so irritated, angry, react, start becoming violent, all that we do, and finally when the mind settles down, somehow one will learn to accept. So acceptance is actually choices. But when I learn to accept things as they are. Now when we say it is choiceless, it means choiceless, what does it mean? I have done my best, and then whatever comes, I have to accept it. It is not that without doing my best, I say that anyway acceptance is choiceless, so whatever will come, I will accept. No, I don't want to do anything about it. Whatever effort I have to put in for any work, I have to put that. So we say that two things are there in life. One is make things happen, another is let things happen. So make things happen is in my control. So I must do that, put the best effort, work hard, make things happen. And after that, let things happen. How will I do anything after that? I can eat food, that is make things happen. So I can cook the best food and I can enjoy a very healthy diet and all that. And after that, I can't do anything. The digestion has to happen on its own. And suppose I know that my digestion is strong, then I can eat what I want to eat, nothing will happen. But once I know that my digestion is weak, the acceptance of that fact also will make me make different choices here. So acceptance is choiceless, and it opens up many, many choices to us. And where it cannot open up choices, it will definitely, that acceptance will make me feel, be at peace. Because I can accept, okay, in this I don't have a choice. That's why they have that serenity prayer, no? That which says that give me the courage to change what I can, the serenity to accept what I can't, and the wisdom to know the difference between the two. That what I can change, what I can't change, I need to, I can do both, and then I must have the wisdom to accept what I can change and what I cannot change. So here is a very beautiful video of Gurudev where he speaks about this. In Gita we have this shloka called Matra Sparshastu Kamdeya Shitoshna Sukha Dukha Daha. And when we live in this world, we will, our sense of senses will contact the sense objects. Our mind will respond to situations. And it will cause physical level heat and cold, emotional level happiness and sorrow, intellectual level success and failure. And these pairs of opposites will come and go. Wise person is one who just holds on, keeping one's balance. That they come and they go. Why should I lose my balance? I learn to accept things as they are.
This is only because of your contact, the right contact with the world, there is nothing wrong. The wrong contact that you get entangled with the world outside. Shitoshna Sukha Dukha Daha, all your experiences of heat and cold, Shitoshna Sukha Dukha, joy and sorrow are all in the way you contact the world. That's it can help. And you open the window. And they will go, personally. You go on living in them. Shitoshna Sukha Dukha, all joy and sorrow, success and failure, loss and gain, is all one way of contact with it, that various experiences. And then what am I to do then? I am here in this world. Agama Vayino Anitya. These are all Agama Vayi. They come and go. One moment is on, and the moment goes. If you go on complaining, you can continue. And if you today something is very beautiful, very beautiful. And Devi Parashvari was saying that it's very hot. Someone has come. After all, that's all. Now today, just do it. Take the record outside. Please, please. Eat and go. You realize that if you keep your ears open, it's wonderful to hear that. That's what I want. But today, no rain at all, something. No rain at all. And I let there be rain for 3 days. Something. Recovery! My people, you know, my father and mother, they don't care for me. All right, father and mother have abandoned. Somebody, they have abandoned, they are not good. They're not good. That's a complaint. Did the wife smile? I don't know why she is smiling so much. See, she just smiled. Why should she? I think she is grinning at me. Now she doesn't smile. It's all very tragic. She's not smiling at all. You must, she must smile exactly the size that you expect her to know. Naturally, you are never happy. Because she is an independent lady. She has got her own ways of smiling. You should have asked her before marriage that you must smile. Let me see. No, that is not the right kind of smile. You understand? He gave up all your own mental projection. Agama, Vayu, Anitya, they are never there the same. They are Agama, Vayu. They come and go. Dham, Diksha, Prabhupada. When they come to you, don't insult. Success and failure. Dham, Dharma, Diksha, Prabhupada, Sahasayadev. Don't get perturbed. Why? By the time you say that I am sick, you have to say that now. What about that? Last 2 days, you know, you are sick, really sick and all. So, the third day I meet you and say, hey, how are you now? Why? I am all right. Heaven, you always say, oh, that was last week. Now I am all right. Last week he was dying. And this week he is planning the next marriage. And so, you know, now you want to watch. Your silent heart and watch your friend crying and you get there from the room because his wife died. You went, you also went, he also went. Third week, you get an invitation card. My marriage, please come. Now, when you go there, you don't know whether to weep or to smile. So, you do both together. And he tries to give you an explanation that you know it's not that I want to marry, but then the three children, small children, to look after them. This is the best babysitter available. It was very doubtful if you keep on watching how people move from one to the other. These are not to be, I mean, should not waste your time in running after up and down. When joy comes, you go beyond the cloud. When sorrow comes, you come crash down. No, keep your balance. Let them come and go. But every one of us will be ups and downs. You have trees of wood leaves in the sea. The sea will have always the waves. And the wood is, whatever that, floating on the waters. Naturally, that wood will have to go up and down according to the rhythm of the waves. Isn't it? But the same waves, or in the same waves, is standing the lighthouse at the harbor. The waves come and break themselves at the feet of the lighthouse, but the lighthouse is not going up and down. Why? Lighthouse is not floating on the surface, but it is built on the foundation of a rock down below. Therefore, the light illumines the waves. The waves come and clash and die away. But the lighthouse stands steady. May you all learn to live like a lighthouse. In the tumultuous changes of situations and circumstances and the world of change and tossing situations in the world, learn to keep your balance. How? By building your life on firm foundation. When all of us are going to float in your life, and you still happen at the mind, and next moment, and gone up and down. Agama, Vayu, Anitya, these are all imperfect. They come and go. No joy can permanently stay with you. No sorrow can permanently stay with you. Then what am I doing? Silently suffer. With integrity. With silent dignity, suffer. Because you know they are not going to be part. They will go away. Adama Vainonitya, Tam Didikshat Sobhara, E Bhagavatama, Tam Didikshat Sobhara, Sabhada, silently, with the dignity and the patience, they will not be permanent. And enjoy yourself in that life. And do achieve what you want to achieve in life without getting knocked down by all these different experiences and come in love.
So, that's the beauty of life, where if our life is built on a firm foundation, like the lighthouse, we can accept all the ups and downs. If we are floating on the surface, acceptance will become very difficult. So we find in life there are these three types of people. First type of person is one who is an escapist. Any challenge comes, wants to run away, doesn't want to face, escape. Person who cannot accept life as it is and finds that it is very difficult to face will want to escape. That's what Arjuna wanted to do, escape. I don't want to fight this war, go on. Why? Because the non-acceptance of that situation. Second is resist. Why this? I don't want this. It should not be like this. Try to change that. Try to resist. Try to do things which are to show one's non-acceptance. Fight, resist. And then the third is a person who accepts that this is how it is and then puts an effort to change. In life, if we, many times each of us also goes through these different three modes. If we learn to accept people as they are, see, when, even if we want people to change, if the person feels that I am accepted as I am, then the person will be more open for change. But if the person feels not accepted, even if you tell that person in the best interest of that person that you do this, you change, the person will not change. Because the person does not feel accepted. So whether it is an individual change in the person outside or change in the society, anything that I want. If I want to do any change like that, acceptance has to happen first. Only through resistance the change cannot happen. And definitely through escaping the change will never happen. That only if I try to escape away, the same situation will come back to me in some other form. So acceptance is something which will give me that strength, that courage to face as it is, whatever it is. If I know that I have anger, I can be in a mode of escapism, saying, no, I don't have any anger. And try to just divert the mind away. Or I can resist, saying, no, not only I don't have any anger, in fact, I get irritable very less. You see, in other my situation, somebody else would have done so much more. Resist. Or I can say that yes, I do have anger. So now how do I learn to manage it? So that change is possible only when there is an acceptance of the fact, not when there is a resistance. In acceptance, the ball is in my court. I accept, yes, this is my limitation. Then only I will work around it. I can open up. If I resist, no, this is not there, just something which just happened. On just a phase that I am going through, then that resistance doesn't allow that change. Hence, acceptance very, very important. I don't remember if I shared this with you earlier, but wherever there is insistence and resistance, there will be sorrow in our life. This person should be like this, this situation should be like this, this business must be like this, this profit must be this much. More I resist, insist, there will be difficulty. And the more I resist whatever has come, again there will be conflict. So the equation for sorrow is this, and the equation for happiness is acceptance and independence. The more I accept things as they are, more the mind will be at peace. Suppose there is a disease or there is an accident or anything. Unexpectedly somebody just arrives. I may have planned to do something else. So many things can happen. And at all those points, if acceptance is there, okay, this has happened, what next? First, I have learned to face life. If I keep resisting, why this happened, I plan so much and still it doesn't work out. And many times they do that with satsang also. Swamiji, I planned so much, and this time I set it aside and I made all arrangements. And that time only my mother-in-law had to invite some guests. Now, what to do? My mind gets disturbed. What was the purpose of coming to satsang? Peace of mind. Now I am not able to come to that satsang itself will create agitation. And sometimes it may be very natural that mind gets agitated. But how do I control at that time? If I learn to train my mind to accept this as it is now. This has come. Accept it. The word is just accept. If I keep telling my mind this, accept as it is. Accept it as it is. Slowly, that mind will learn. And that mind which has learned to accept everything as it is a mind which can maintain its balance and equanimity. So equanimity and acceptance are very closely connected. Peace of mind and acceptance very closely connected. Change and acceptance very closely connected. Love and acceptance also very closely connected. Acceptance is a very powerful aspect of our life, and that acceptance will bring all these into our lives. No. See, I think the beginning part, some part was missed out. So when you accept something as it is not that I am approving that this should be like this only. Acceptance and approval are not one and the same. If I understand that my child is weak in this particular subject, I accept it. Then I can do whatever I need to supplement. If I know that my health is weak, and I can accept that I will take exercise or food or anything. So, accepting a situation will not make me complacent, will not make me just resign, okay, this is how it is. It is not, that is not called footing. In fact, acceptance is that foundation on which the lighthouse stands. That life will bring, the waves will be there up and down and they will crash. But I have a choice. If I accept, I don't get destroyed with them. I stand firm. Even our country, I gave that example earlier. There is enough corruption happening. If I am in a denial mode, in psychology they always say denial mode. If I constantly keep denying, then I can't change that situation. So many crimes are happening in our country. How long can one keep denying? One has to know that this is a reality. Then only things can change. So many times we don't know the fact. Many times we know the fact and we can't accept it. These are two different situations. Knowing the fact and then accepting is the wise person's choice. So India is a very young country. But we don't know. Many of us don't know that every 90 minutes one teenager is committing a suicide. One doesn't know only those facts. 25%, not even 25% of our graduates are employable. That's the situation. So if I know this very fact very clearly, this is the situation, ground reality is this. Now I have to accept that fact. Then the change can happen in the education system. The change can happen in such a way that the minds of young people get empowered, that they do not get into these kind of situations where they going to drugs, depression, suicide, it should not happen. But if I just escape from that situation, saying, no, no, India is a very young country, we have the strength, we have the capacity, we have the power. What is the ground reality? Something else only. Or I resist saying, no, no, this is just, you know, media hyping it, but it's not like this. Again, nothing can be done. So I must acknowledge and accept the fact. I should know the fact and I should accept the fact. Both have to happen. So in life, when there is this acceptance and independence, happiness has to happen. Either of these are absent, mind will be very disturbed. So acceptance first begins with self-acceptance. There's a lot of connection between accepting people, situations, things as they are and accepting myself as I am. So if there is self-acceptance, there is self-love and there is no self-condemnation, then only there can be any acceptance of other people and things as they are. You know, one of the reasons why we are not able to accept people as they are is because we are not able to accept ourselves as we are. Somewhere there will be some attachment, somewhere there will be some unresolved part in my mind. And so we have to ask ourselves this question, that can I accept myself as I am, both with strengths and weaknesses? It's an objective view of the situation. It is not avoiding the negative and only hyping the positive, nor is it only focusing on the negative to grow. But I should know who I am in both the positive and the negative. Suppose there is a toothache, what will you do? Simple, go to a doctor, and if the doctor says this is the problem and you have to take this medicine, or after some time you will have to get a root canal done, what will we do? We will follow that. Will we ever sit down and condemn ourselves? What a fool I am. What an idiot I am, I got a toothache. There is no worse person in the world than me, I got a toothache. Will anybody do that? But why are we doing that for other aspects of life? So much of beating up, bashing up ourselves we do. So much of self-condemnation that we do. There is a weakness, agreed. There may be anger, there may be irritability, impulsiveness, greed, jealousy, any of these. But can I treat that as objectively as I treat a toothache or a cold? If I can do that, then the mind has learned to accept myself as I am. This wood example that Gurudev gave, that it goes up and down with the floating wave, that example applies in both these cases to us. That when there is a negativity, we bash ourselves up so much, and when there is some good achievement that we have, again we go high up somewhere. So the balance is not there. If a person learns to accept both the weakness and the strength as they are, without self-condemnation, then that person has healthy self-love. And remember, healthy self-love is not ego. Unfortunately, people feel that if I love myself, it is selfish and it is egoistic. It is not. A lot of problems in the world today are all because we don't have a healthy self-esteem. Why do people go into depression? Why do some of them even get brainwashed to do terrorist activities? Why do some people face so much of agitation in their mind and stress and anxiety? One of the reasons is because the healthy self-love is not there. So I am always depending on something else for my self-esteem and self-worth. In the corporate world especially, the way in which the whole world works here also is your work will determine your worth. And Vedanta says, no. Dealing, your work and your worth need not be connected. Because if the worth you have very strong, then I am a worthy individual no matter who I am, what I am. I can keep improving, no doubt. Then only I can be best in my work. Otherwise, I will go up and down like the wood. So a person who learns to love himself and love his positives or her positives more than the limitations, that is healthy self-love. And that healthy self-love is a very important foundation for acceptance. And that healthy self-love is an important foundation for me to accept people also as they are. If I want to love my child as the child and give my best to the child, I can give my best only when I am in that situation. If I feel low about myself, somewhere that will get transferred on to my child. In Mahabharata, this is beautifully depicted. Dhritarashtra never felt worthy enough in his life. He was blind, born blind. He wanted to become the king, and Vidur objected, saying, "You cannot become the king. How will a blind person take proper decision? You can't rule." So Pandu was made the king. Eventually, Pandu got a curse here. He abandoned the kingdom and he went away. And Dhritarashtra became the king. And even after becoming the king, his sense of inferiority never went. Whole life he grew up as an inferior person. And if you see the inferiority in his life, transferred on to Duryodhan. So constantly Duryodhan kept on comparing. Just like Dhritarashtra kept comparing himself with Pandu, this Duryodhan kept comparing himself with Bhim. Kept on feeling inferior. Why? Because healthy self-love is not there. I don't love myself as I am. I don't love my positives more than my limitations. So where there is self-condemnation, where there is non-acceptance of certain facts, there the self-worth will be low and it will transfer on to people around me. And hence it is very, very necessary that I learn to accept myself as I am. In the same Mahabharata, there is another example of Ekalavya. No? Dronacharya did what he did because he was attached to his disciple Arjuna. So he took away the right thumb of Ekalavya. Now Ekalavya could have been very disappointed and depressed, and he would have gone into depression, saying that this only one thumb I had and it all he took away, and how will I be a great archer and all that stuff. He can do all that. But he accepts the fact, okay, this is what it is. My guru asked his guru Lakshana and I gave it to him. And do you know that Ekalavya did not leave archery? He continued to practice archery with these two fingers. And he mastered archery. And he actually fought in the Mahabharata war from the side of the Kauravas. He had no inferiority complex. In fact, the guru wanted to make him feel like that. You just think about it. He wanted Arjuna to be the best archer, so he took away this fellow's thumb. He could have felt like that, whole world is conspiring against me. But no. Because he had his self-worth in his place. He said, doesn't matter. I love archery and I will do what I need to do. Continue. So people who have that strong sense of self-worth, where they don't depend on achievements and other people and recognition and none of those, such people are able to face all the adversities of life more strongly. And not only are they more accepting of themselves, they are more accepting of life and people around them. Hence we say that the more acceptance I have about myself, easier I will be able to accept people and things around. Hence in the Gita it is said, lift yourself by yourself, never condemn yourself. Vivekananda said, if there is one sin in life, it is inferiority. Inferiority can make me do anything. It can drive me to desperation. My decisions can go wrong. My relationships can go haywire. And generally it is found that people who are very critical of other people, who keep pointing their faults, etc., because they don't have that healthy self-love. And so they derive that, what we can call it, they feel worthy, they feel good only when they put down somebody else. that you are like this, you are like that, you are not improving and so many weaknesses you have and I am still tolerating you. All those things happen is only because there is no healthy self-acceptance of oneself. And one is not focusing, one is escaping from that and putting it on somebody else. So where there is love, healthy self-love within, I will be able to love people also as they are. Hence, self-condemnation is something which should not be done. It is very, very harmful. Now we come to certain levels of acceptance. So one aspect of acceptance is I should learn to accept my past. Very important that aspect is. That no matter what has happened in my past, can I come to terms with it? Saying, fine, this has happened. I should learn my lesson out of it and drop that regret. When we don't learn the lesson out of it, it's because I am not accepted. I was born in this particular family, or I did not get this type of education, or this person misbehaved with me, or this wrong thing happened, or this accident happened, or something happened. And sometimes I live in that memory for so many years and feel victimized. If I want to move on with my life, I have to learn from my past and I have to let go of the regrets. Second aspect I must learn to accept is my present as it is and let go of the tension. So the mantra to let go, the mantra is learn and let go for the past, here and now for the present. That can I bring my mind back again and again to here and now? Not imagine about the past, not imagine about the future, but be here and now. What is the situation right now? And learn to accept it as it is. And then comes the third one, the future. That anxiety comes to me because I am not sure whether I can face my future or not. If I have that healthy self-love and self-worth, I will always say that yes, I can. That I can attitude is born from that healthy self-love. Confidence is born from that healthy self-love. And whatever comes, I can face it. However tough the situation, maybe I can. In absence of that faith and that strength within, the mind always feels anxious. I don't know what will happen tomorrow. Anxiety will be there. So in acceptance, if I can accept my past as it is, learn from it if I need to change anything, let go of the memories. Everybody makes mistakes, and in that forgiveness is a very powerful aspect in acceptance of the past. I may make a mistake, somebody else make a mistake, intentional, unintentional, whatever it is. Can I learn to forgive and let go so that I keep moving on? Especially in relationships. We don't accept people as they are only because we can't let go and we can't forgive. And we carry on that for many, many years. That spoils the present relationship. So one is this, let me learn to accept past, present and future. Past, whatever has happened, come to terms with it. Present, whatever is happening, focus on that. And future, have the faith that you can accept and face whatever will come. Second, at the emotion level, there will be many, many emotions that come and go. If there is anger at this moment, can I accept that yes, I am very angry? The moment I accept that yes, there is anger in me right now, that itself puts a break. And I don't need to feel bad about that after that. Otherwise, there is anger, then there is guilt, that why did I get angry? I am a spiritual person and I'm still getting angry, and so I am not doing great, and somewhere there is something wrong which is happening. So now one problem was anger, second problem is guilt, third problem is self-condemnation. Now I have hodgepodged it up totally. This is not to justify anger, but this is to make me aware that okay, right now I am going through this. And it can be applied for everything, even the positive ones. In fact, for positive ones, one has to apply more. Some success that happens, many times we break boundaries because we feel so elated. We'll end up harming ourselves and somebody else. So both positive and the negative, if I accept that emotion as it is at that moment, and I say that right now I am going through this, can I be with it? Haven't we seen that many times when we go through something, at that point we don't know. And so if somebody asks us something, we say, no, right now I can't tell. Much later we find out that this is what happened to me at that point in time, this is what I was going through, and then we get back to that person. Why? Because the mind is not able to accept, mind is lost in that particular emotion. So in Gita it is said, they are in me, I am not in them. That will just give me a little bit of space that yes, anger is in me, pride is in me, or jealousy is in me, but I am not in them. I am watching it. What that does to me is that branding will stop. Anger is an emotion which came and it went. I don't have to brand myself, I am an angry person. If that objectivity comes in my life, then I will be able to handle that. If that objectivity is not there, I keep on branding myself. Just think about it. So many people who become so depressed when they don't get what they want. One of the main reasons is they cannot stand apart from it. Very easy it is to say that, you know, failure is an event, it is not me. Many times you would have heard that statement. But when that failure happens, then the mind is not able to take it like that. Mind always feels, I am a failure. Mind is not able to create that space. That in this event I didn't achieve, that's all. And today they have a results, I learn to expect a result and work very hard, and when the result comes, I learn to accept it. That is called prasada buddhi. Acceptance of the result does not mean don't expect any result. Gita doesn't say don't expect a result and work. Gita says expect a result, work hard, but don't insist on a specific result. Whatever result comes, accept it. That's the beautiful philosophy of it. Bhagavan Krishna, who wanted to protect righteousness, he wants that result or not. Dharma, to be protected. So he is working hard towards that. So when the result comes, one has to accept. Very difficult it may be to accept. In fact, the Pandavas, when they won, they are in a more sorry state if you think about it. Duryodhan even laughs at Yudhishthira, saying, look, I am going to die, but you have to live here. And everybody has got killed. Except those five Pandavas, Kripacharya, Ashwatthama. That's it. Krishna, Vidur. Nobody else is alive. All those Pandavas, Kauravas, relatives, kings, so many of them, they all have died. So much of destruction in the society. The ratio of male and female, that has got destroyed. Culture has got destroyed. So many children have become orphans. All that has happened. Material wealth has got destroyed. So many things have happened. And these Pandavas have to re-establish this whole thing again. So Duryodhan actually laughs at him. He says, what price have you even attained this success in the world? And Yudhishthira says very nice thing. He said, no price is less for protection of dharma. If dharma is protected, everything else is there. And if everything else is there and dharma is not protected, nothing has meaning. It will just be wasted. It's only a matter of time. So that person could accept at that point in time also that yes, this is the result of the war. This is what we stood for to protect righteousness. And we have paid a price, and it's a very heavy price for it, but I accept whatever the price is. So the result he could accept as it came. People who work like that, that when results come, they accept. And if it is not pleasing result, they can work to improve that. They can work more hard to manifest that in the next time. They are the people who are objective. But you become very dejected, you know, I didn't get what I want, and I don't think I will ever get. Nothing great can be achieved. So, acceptance of my own past, acceptance of my emotions in the present, acceptance of the results, and acceptance of situations. Take things as they come and leave them as they go. In Sanskrit, it is called Agate Swagatam Kuryat Gacchantam Nanivarayet. Whatever comes, welcome it. And when it goes, say Tata bye bye, let it go. Our problem will be when it comes, many things we don't want it to come. And when it goes, some things we don't want it to go. So things when they come, success will come, welcome it. And we should know that it will go one day. When it goes, it goes. That's the pair of opposite, how life works. So there will be praise. Somebody will praise me a lot. And suddenly that same person will turn around and criticize. Take things as they come, leave them as they go. If this detachment we learn, more about this is our next, I think next week's topic is detachment. So I will tell you more about it when we go ahead. But that detachment is what is acceptance all about. Detachment and acceptance are one and the same thing. And so the person who learns to accept all these, and then we come to people. We find it so easy to accept things, but very difficult to accept people. Do I expect a lemon to taste very sweet? Do I expect that a tiger will eat grass? And having accepted each one as they are, have I not adjusted myself? But why can't I do that with people? If I learn to accept them as they are, is that not the freedom that I also want, that people should accept me as I am? So I must learn to accept them as they are. And each one will grow at their own pace. How can we force anything? Two seeds which are sown in the soil, both of them will not give flower at the same time, even if all the inputs are the same. Each one will give flower at different time. Each one will grow at its own pace. So in people's life also, in our life also, people, all of them will grow at different pace. Each one has their own, they have come with their own baggage. So we may find that, hey, this is so easy, why don't you just do this? But they have certain baggage which is not allowing them to do certain things so fast. Maybe they will take more time, or they may not be able to do it. It may not be their temperament. So if I learn to accept people as they are and adjust, how will that happen? Only when I understand them and not brand them, not label them. This is where the self-acceptance comes. If I don't label myself, then only I can live in such a way that I don't label other people. If I constantly keep labeling myself, I will label other people also. That creates the different difficulty in accepting people as they are. So, in accepting each other's flaws and celebrating each other's weakness, strengths, that's what one has to do. How do we live in relationships that way? Accepting the person as they are. It will all depend on my attitude. And how I look at myself and how much I love myself. And so if the focus is on how much love can I give, that much easier it will be to accept people. But if the focus is on you should do this, you should do that, you should speak like this, you should behave like this, then accepting people will be very tough. The same mother who loves the child so unconditionally, suddenly when the child grows up, becomes so difficult to accept. Why? Because now my expectations have come. The mother's expectation has come. Earlier the acceptance was that this is a child, this is the way the child is. And that acceptance was there. Then slowly the expectation started coming in. That by this age he should be like this, by that age he should be like this. And then that conditioning starts working. So the more focus is on giving love, that what best can I do to give, to serve. Again, easier said than done. But some of these are what help us also to manifest our potential of loving and also help us to accept people as they are. And especially, don't we see even in education now, once they understand that somebody is a slow learner, somebody has a certain, what they call as a
challenge.
Somebody has dyslexia. Now, accordingly, once the acceptance is there, that movie had come, Tare Zameen Par. The parent does not even know that the child has dyslexia. And so constantly the expectation of the parent is that this elder brother of yours is like this and so bright, so brilliant, and why are you not like this? You are duffer, you are lazy, you are like that. Constant branding is happening, judging is happening. Because the effort has been not put to understand that why this person is like this. Acceptance is very powerful there. It will make me understand why this person is doing this. It will make me step back. I can watch more clearly. And then my whole response will change. The moment that father came to know that this child has dyslexia, whole approach changed. Because now he understood the problem. That the problem is not that child is unwilling, he has a disability. So accepting people and understanding them, they go together. When I start understanding them without branding them, that's where that self-love works. So in the Vivek Chudamani, there's a beautiful example which is given, and that is the example of a cracked pot. The cracked pot example is to represent actually a man of realization. Suppose there is a pot and you keep putting things into it. So there is curd, then you put some strawberry juice, then you put some lemon into it, and you put some chas into it. What will that container be after some time? It will be rotten content inside, stinking, one can't handle it. Imagine our mind is like that. We keep putting one by one, so many things inside that. And so many things are there for many, many years, they are rotting there. The example of a cracked pot is the man of realization does not allow anything to remain. The impressions don't remain. They keep becoming empty. So life can just flow. He can just flow through life as it is. Doesn't have specific expectation, insistence, doesn't hold on. Let life pass. Let it go on as it goes. Things come, very good. People come, very good. People leave, it's okay. One continues. Again, somebody else will come, continues life. So one doesn't create obstructions by one's resistance, by one's attachments and resistance. Keeps accepting. This is how life is. So that is the example of a cracked pot. It doesn't hold anything in itself. It learns to become empty. And that emptiness is a criteria for great success in life. If great music has to be produced, the flute has to be empty. So emptiness, music requires emptiness of the flute. Poem requires emptiness of a paper on which you write. A beautiful window's emptiness is required to see the scenery outside. Same way, to know the self, to experience happiness, emptiness of the self is important. But can I let go of that ego? Because ego is that which comes in between. Only two things prevent me from attachment, non-acceptance. One is my attachment, second is my ego. How will that ego go? By this bhav, that I am an instrument, the Lord is the tool. Let things happen. I am only a nimitta, I am an instrument. So Bhagavan tells Arjun that even if you don't fight, Arjun, don't think that Kauravas will escape. Their karma will come to them. You only be an instrument. Just be a nimitta. So can I be the best instrument? Where I am available, let life take its own course. What I need to do as a duty, let me do. Arjun is doing his duty. Not that he becomes purposeless, directionless. You know, now I don't know what to do. Bhagavan is a doer, so I can't do anything now. Not like that. He is doing his duty to protect righteousness, but deep down he knows that I am not the doer, I am only an instrument. So we will have our plans, we will have our things to achieve and so many aspects in life. But deep down we should know we are only instruments. So having done our best, if any result comes, I should learn to accept it as it comes. Because in the bigger picture, I am only an instrument. So he says, even if you don't fight, somebody else will fight. So better be an instrument and attain the glory. Why are you escaping away from here? So three attitudes for acceptance is what we will see. One attitude of acceptance is that I get what I deserve. Let me go through it in dignity. That is the attitude of karma and humility. That if this has come to me, it has come only because I deserve it. Meaning, I would have done something in the past. That is the cause. So today this is the effect. Nothing happens which is not deserved by me. There is nothing random happening. If something has come, there must be some cause for it. Either in immediate past or in the distant past. But there must be a cause. And how I face it now is my choice. Fate and free will, when we spoke about, we have done elaborate detail on this. And if something has come, then it is a choice. I mean, it's a fact that it is because I have done something to deserve. Many times people use it in a bad way. That's why we can't accept this. Many times people think that, you know, if you are going through a disease, people say you must have done some bad karma in the past, you know, that's why you are facing this. You are a papi, I tell you. Or some loss happens and somebody thinks that you are being punished for your sins. Gurudev always said, you are not punished for your sins, you are punished by your sins. I did something wrong. I did not have a healthy lifestyle in the past, so I am in what condition I am today? Over. I don't need to condemn myself for it. But I need to accept that yes, I must have done something in the past. In some cases, I know the cause. In many cases, I don't know the cause. And there is no need to go and find out that cause. I just need to accept. Even those who do past life regression, do you think past life regression helps them to accept the situation as it is and feel free? Or is it that when they understood the incident, they have learned to accept, oh, this is what happened? That knowledge of that incident of the past has only made them learn to accept it, that's all. Why do I need to go to that past experience and that incident to learn to accept? If in the moment I can have the knowledge that if this has come to me, there must be some cause, let me just go through this in a balanced way. I don't have to ask why this to me. No need. So one attitude of acceptance is, if this has come, I must have deserved. Second, bhakti attitude is that it is the grace of the Lord. Whatever happens, happens for the good. Today I may not know the cause. I may not know the blessing in it. I just need to have that faith. If I have that faith in the Lord, that the Lord is the supreme intelligence, who is the giver of the fruits of my actions and my well-wisher. If this is what Bhagavan has sent as prasad, I learn to accept it. It must be for my good. I may or may not be able to see it now. Like the medicine may be very bitter, but the parent will give it or the doctor will give it to the patient or to the child. And the child has faith in the doctor or the parent, the child will take it. however bitter it is. So that's the bhakti approach. And the third approach is the knowledge approach, which will say that even this will pass. What you just saw in that clip of Gurudev, it is temporary. Agamaha apainad. It comes and it goes. I am a witness, I am an observer of that. All the three will help me to accept life as it comes. And the more we learn to accept life as it comes, more we are at peace. So in the Gita, Bhagavan says, Yagat Shantihi Anantaram. The moment I let go of my non-acceptance, instant is the peace. And obviously it will open up any choice that I have to change anything that I need to. So that is about power of acceptance, and the mantra is very simple. The very word accept is the mantra. And I keep telling myself, I accept. I accept. In Hindi it is said, Svikara. If I want to accept that, yes, I accept as it is. So the person must feel loved and accepted where there is no sense of you are inadequate. Many times we make somebody feel you are inadequate. You don't dress properly, or you don't do this, or you don't do that, and you know. So as I gave the example of the toothache, I can tell something in a very objective way, or I can tell with a lot of psychological damage. When I tell something to somebody, like I always say that criticize the performance and encourage the performer. The way in which we criticize sometimes is to criticize the performer. You are no good, you are useless, what will you do? How many times I have told you, but I don't think you can ever change. Then that person is already building a wall, and we are already making that person feel inadequate. How will the person ever change? So if the person has to feel accepted, it has to be communicated, for which is where I must have love. And that love is not only for that person, for me, myself. You just think, when we feel love for someone and when we have love about ourselves, don't we express the same thing in a very polite, positive, non-hurting way, non-personal way? But when we are disturbed and it is affecting me, and immediately we don't bother about the opposite person. We just fire off. That's why the person feels non-accepted. Easier to forgive and more difficult to forget.
Sometimes, like, forgive the person what they've done, but the remembrance stays.
So the functional memory is not a problem, but the psychological hurt still stays, because I have not healed myself. I have not accepted. I have not completely let go of it. I have let go of the incident. I have let go of a bitterness about that person, but I may not have let go of the impact that that situation had on me, and so I have not yet healed myself, and so that forgiveness is still partial. Complete forgiveness will heal me psychologically from inside. It could also be that I have not forgiven myself in that situation, that why did I allow this thing to happen, or how careless I was, or how dumb I was, or anything. If I have not forgiven myself, then that will keep coming back to me also. So I will relive the hurt. That could be one reason. Other reason also could be sometimes we derive our self-esteem from our hurts also. To some extent, our hurts make us feel comfortable. It's a contradictory fact, but it is a fact. That I feel that I have a justification now for the way I am, because know, this person did like this to me, and that person did like this, and life did this to me, and you know, I have forgiven that person, but I have felt deprived. I have felt that injustice has been done to me, and I have not let go of that. And I am holding on to that. Because I have not fulfilled myself, I have not said, you know, I let go of this, and there are other ways by which I can feel more complete or better or adequate. So then I hold on to that. So then it keeps coming back. Because we have been taught a very different way of growing. We have been taught to grow by focusing on the mistakes. And the more I focus on the mistakes, I am not able to accept myself. Because that's inadequacy. That's the problem then. If I focus on my strengths and objectively handle my weaknesses, there is no problem. I will have healthy self-acceptance. But I am always taught, no, suppose I did not get good, suppose I am not good in English language. It's a functional problem. There's nothing psychological about it. But then the psychological branding will make me feel inadequate. Saying, you know, you don't know English, how will you even progress? You don't know this, you don't know that. So the person is made to feel psychologically inadequate. Where will self-acceptance come? For small things, you know, some particular skill one doesn't learn, or is not having control over some emotion. So many aspects of either the upbringing or the society, or I myself, the way I handle myself is condemned. And the condemnation is never objective, it is always psychological. So.
Should, unless, until, if, and but. So, if the 7 words you sort of let go, then
you have accepted. Nice one. Good, should. You can just write. Yeah, so, what are those words? Good. Good, good,
should, unless,
until,
if and but.
If, but. Nice one. This is what positive psychology. Okay. Good, should, unless, until, if and but. Remove this from your vocabulary also.
Exactly. We come in the way of
acceptance. Until is most powerful. Until you don't do this, I will not forgive you. Until. And best part is that person has finished the job and gone, but I am still holding on to that.
But also, everything is nice, but.
Yeah. So next week our topic will be power of detachment. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Shri Guru.